Alright guys, welcome to the second class for Beginner Track in 0-Day Cybersecurity Club. In this class, we'll try to go through the Linux file systems, text formatting commands, string manipulation commands, and some networking commands. I'll try to finish all of them today. Like again, if something is remaining, we'll move it to the next class. So let's start with the directories itself. I might have put it in the comments also, but just a reiteration. The tilde symbol is denotes your home directory. Like for example, I'm root. For root, if I do cd, the tilde symbol is shift plus the button before your one. You'll notice it. If you do cd tilde, then see it shows tilde. But if I do pwd, pwd is to tell your present working directory. If I put that in, you'll see it's slash root. Similarly, if I was user Kali, it will be slash home slash Kali. Since most of my files are still in home Kali, I'll cd there. Another thing is, there is something called relative directories. So for example, if I do cd dot, dot denotes the current directory. So if I do cd dot, you'll see nothing will change. If I do cd dot dot, it'll go to the directory before Kali. That is home, right? Slash home. So it's like a tree. You just go one branch above, and similarly if I do one more time, it'll go to the root directory, because that is the like the most uppermost, like the root directory in itself is the root. There is nothing more lower than the root directory. So what does the root directory contain? It contains most of them are common for like all Linux system, but each of them has their own purpose. Like slash bin holds your user binary. So for example, most of you guys have installed OpenVPN, right? So have you noticed, like, you don't have to specify the path every time. You don't have to do maybe if it's in slash bin slash OpenVPN, it's not required, because you can directly do it. So most of your commands which do not require your relative pathing are in the bin and some other ones. You'll see sbin and user sbin. To check what all are such commands are possible, you can do something called echo $path. So whichever binaries are available inside these folders, those are the ones that are directly available to you in the terminal without any path specifications or anything. Other than that, almost everything in Linux requires the path, because you need to make sure in the right location. I think most of you had the problem with the OpenVPN stuff too. That is the same reason, because imagine if your file is somewhere in /home/kali 0-day, maybe here. Yeah, imagine there's a text file here. If I can remember, cat was the command last time I used to display the contents of the file. So if I do cat a.txt here, it'll work. I can see the file. But if I go one directory back, if I go to home Kali and do the same command, if a.txt doesn't exist here and I still do cat a.txt, it won't work. And that was the reason most of the errors came. But I can still access it from here. The easiest way would be like cat, the directory is 0-day, right? If I do 0-day slash a.txt, it'll work. It'll still work. So that directory is very important. Again, this is relative to the current directory. The actual, if you want to absolute, it'll be /home/kali/0-day/a.txt. That is the right like absolute path. So hopefully that should clear some of the problems. Next, let's come back to the Linux system. So yeah, bin holds your binary. So if I go to cd bin, ls. So these commands are the ones that are like directly available to you from the terminal. And you would see Python 3 last time I tried, right? Python 3 directly. I didn't have to do /bin/python3 because it's in the bin folder or any of the other path folders you notice. So this holds your third party binaries like CNC and stuff that does not exactly deal with the system, but are crucial to it. Like I will cover some of these binaries later in the class. Okay, so that was the function of slash bin. Next is etc. etc holds your configuration file. So like, for example, which network, how many networks, and you know, hosts, how many hosts are in your current you know, connected to the machine, all configuration files. So you will see there are a lot. Each of them will correspond to that particular will either it be a system related or the third party binaries, you know, require them. Some famous one are etc host. You will manipulate them a lot as you climb through the, I think, intermediate and advanced. You use etc a lot. Sudo, I think sudoers, now most of you must have understood the importance of that sudoers. So sudoers file will have who all can do the sudo command themselves, like without any password and anything. I put a tutorial on the Discord chat for the ones who are interested. So yeah, these ones are created because of my this system. The other important ones are media. Media holds the removable devices. For example, you connected a USB to your Kali. To this OS, not just Kali, in fact, in Linux system general, that will show up in the CD folder. In Fedora CD media, it will show up there. Right now, I don't have a USB to connect to Kali, so let's not do that. Okay, so proc will have your process information. So the current processes, remember last class, I told you something about the PS command, right? That holds the, it's like the task manager. It holds all the processes that is running during that time. So you can have more information about them in the proc folder. We do an LSC, those are all the you know, different processes, the threads that are running, and much more, a bit more complicated stuff is happening here. All right, next proc sbin. Sbin is like a bin, but sbin is for more system related file. If I do shutdown, maybe that is not a third party, you know, binary. It is inbuilt and required by the system itself. So that is in the shutdown, that is in the sbin folder. So do an ls, you can find it here, the sbin, yeah, okay, I can't find it here, but it will be somewhere here. Like all the system related commands are mostly here, the ones that are required by the system at all times. Right, forget that. That's not maybe. Boot is for your booting, bootloader binaries and other softwares will be there, home, I think that is your home directory where you store usual your all your files and everything. In fact, your default directory, as you saw, tilde, is in the home. If you do cd home, it should usually has the all the users. For example, you created a new user here, it will come in one more folder, it will create a new folder called maybe the username, like that. So that is home. Next is library. Library is like similar library files. For like, for example, since most of these binaries are C, written in C, C++, and like that, they'll require libraries, right? So all those are there in the lib folder. So yeah, each one is another folder in general, and you do that. Yeah, modules, there are a lot. Yeah, see, that is a dot so. So those are all binaries required for the binary to run. Okay. Next, MNT. MNT is to mount a file system. The concept of mounting in general is a whole another topic. Let's think for now as is to like access some particular file systems for a short period of time. Like for example, you have an entire disk ready with you, some disk file ready with you. Or like for example, your ISO files, you want to mount that ISO file in Kali to maybe see what it is, contents or anything. You can mount and, you know, check all the contents in it. And once the you are done with it, you can unmount. That for settings will be available in the /mnt. Yeah, root, I think, is the root directory, /root. It's the home directory for the root user. I guess, yeah, that should make sense. Next, SRV again will... It's dependent on the different, it's another made placeholder for another type of commands. USR is for your user programs. So if you like install, like now if you install like an OpenVPN or something, that's installed by you, right? It is not pre-installed like or stored in sbin or bin. That might usually be in USR. So if I do USR bin ls, so yeah, these are the ones that is, you know, some more binaries which are available. I think here it might be there, not so sure, but I still check. open VPN, right? Open VPN. Okay, it's not here, but it'll be somewhere. We'll figure it out. And yeah, if you do want to check directly instead of doing it manually, you can do just switch OpenVPN. That will tell exactly where the folder is in. It's an user has been. It's a system binary in the user folder because we installed it ourselves. So it'll be somewhere in here. User has been and OpenVPN. OpenVPN is the binary that is running when every time you use it. So that. You, most of the time, you will not deal with most of these files. It's just for your reference so that if any need to troubleshoot, these things will be useful. DEV is for device. It's similar to the MNT and media, but except this is for your hard drives, in, like total hard drives. That's your permanent devices. Like what is, where is the current system running on? It's inside the dev. So if I do CD dev, yeah. So these are the processes that are running, and basically this is related to all the current hard disk that is mounted, and this will never go out. The dev is permanent, unlike media and MNT, which we can remove or not remove the file systems. This is fixed. OPT is for other, it's just an optional, what you call, optional apps kind of thing. Usually nothing is there. I have put most of my binaries here. It's just the official definition is optional apps or add-on apps, and you can add your another binaries, a set of binaries there. Yeah, I think, yeah. Other ones are not necessary. These were the ones that are definitely required. And one more is var. VAR is your variable folder. For example, you wanna run your HTML, if you wanna run a HTML server in general, usually you put it in the var wwwhtml and run web servers using Apache 2 or Nginx or any other software. So that's another important folder you'd have to remember. And yeah, maybe temp. When's temp? Temp is not here. Oh, temp is here. Yeah, okay. Yeah. Temp is a temporary folder. It just is for temporary files in general. Anyone can edit and usually access this place. It'll be very important once you come into the exploitation part. So yeah, that is most of the file system in Linux. Now that that is done, let's move on to file permissions. Last time when I did ls, right, wait, first let's get into a decent directory. Kali 0 day ls. Yeah, remember I told you some parameters we use, minus a for dot files. There's no dot files. For example, if I do cat dot secret, something like that. Oh, not cat, touch. Cat is to display the contents, touch is to create a file, right? So if I do touch dot secret and do an ls, it'll not be shown here normally. It's like a hidden file, but you wanna see it, it's ls minus a, right? Now you see it. So like that, I told you some more parameters, right? Ls minus a lh, that is the one usually I use. H is for, I think, human readable format or something like that. So now when you see, when I did l, it do a like proper listing, long listing format. Most of these are fine. I think these are just related to who owns the user, who can run it, the size, I think last modified or first mod, I'm not sure. If you have any doubts about that, you can always do man. I think I told this last class also. Man ls, man is for manual. It will give you a page where which will have a short summary of the what the command does and parameters and much more detailed information about them. It is a very useful tool. So if you have any doubts with any of the tools, do a man after that, put your command in and check what does it do, what can it do, what you are doing wrong maybe, and stuff like that. Yeah, what was I checking? Ls minus l, capital L. Yeah, it's the long listing format. Sure, I think it's the last check. Anyway, so the point is when we come to file permissions, these are the ones that is important. You'll have to think of these as a set of three. The first letter is D. It will be D or nothing. D usually denotes the directory. D is the dot is the current directory, dot is the relative before directory. So here it will be /home/kali. Chal here is another directory. We'll come to that later. Then, yeah. So if it's a directory, it's D or else nothing. The next three are important. So it's divided into user, group, and world, right? Let me just check if I have always any other doubts. Always check chmod. Let me just give me a second. Alright. Usually the first three are for the root user root folder. The next three are for the group, and the final three are for the world. So world wasn't anybody can access that. The group, as in particular groups, can access that, and the root user. So it's in terms of three. Groups of three. It is read, write, execute. So read, write, execute, and read, write, execute. So yeah, as you can see, the root user will almost always have read write permissions. The last one is depends if you want it to be an executable file. An executable file is basically a binary, a software. Can you run it directly? Is it a compiled file, or is it a compiled Python file or something like that? So to create permissions, you use the chmod. That's what I was doing that time. And you specify the binary bits. So three, right? Imagine 1, 1, 1. In binary, 1, 1, 1 is 7, right? So this would be 7. Next one would be, imagine 1, and if there's nothing, it's a 0 and another 1. So 101, what is 101 in binary, from binary to decimal?
5.
Exactly, so 7, then 5, then for the last one, this one. So again, another 5, so 7, 5, 5. That is the file permission for the current directory. For similarly, you can add your own permissions. So for example, you want this hi.py to be only accessible by the root user, right? So I'll just put 700, correct? 7 means root, 0 means no access to anyone else, and hi.py. Now if I do an ls, I got ls minus l. Yeah, you can see that, right? Now the other bits are gone. So it's always in bits of three. And that's how you change the permissions of the file. The D is just to indicate a directory. You can't change that. So yeah, about that. All right. So it's a root, a group, and your world. So that, So that was about file permissions. Again, I'll be just giving a short introduction to these tools. I'll not be going into too much detail. You can always look into it. Maybe use the man. Or you can Google it, because file permissions are something that is much more bigger than what I told right now. And you can change the ownership. You can, there are multiple exploits based on permissions that you'll learn later. So that's something to look up to. Next, now that file permissions is done, let's move to, let's go to the text formatting, string formatting. So these are really important tools, because you will use them a lot after these classes. For the either it will be in the Try Hack Me pages, or for the Bandit series we'll have to do for this assignment and this week's assignment, and later for CTFs and for later stages. So let's start with grep. Let's do one chal one. Imagine you have 1,000 like text files right here, okay, and in some one file there's maybe a password hidden. It's really hard to manually search through that, right? Manually open it and search the particular file, but you know there's a password somewhere in these 100 files and stuff like that. In times like that, grep is the command you'll use, because yeah, that's for searching pattern. For example, grep, the basic is the pat. Like after you put the pattern, like for example, password, I want to search for password. Okay, and where do I want to search it? I want to search it in the current folder, right? For folder, there's a parameter called minus r. It uses minus r a lot. In fact, the next commands will also hinge on that. So, and the last one would be the folder where you want to search for this string. I want to search for all the files in the current folder. Current folder is what? Dot, right? Dot. So see, it is only there in 51.txt and 68.pass. So it showed you, and it's in the script which I created to make it, obviously. To create this challenge. Obviously, I didn't make 100 txt files. I wrote a script for that. Yeah, so that's one way to like quickly search through something. This will be useful, like, for example, you want to find a database file, or you know, like, example here only, like, you want to search that particular phrase, password. In CTF, you want to find the flag. This would be a really useful tool. There are many more applications of this tool. These are the ones I use the most. And maybe a small quiz, not quiz, a small assignment kind of thing for you. Just search it out. How do you do this without cases? Like, you want to make it case insensitive. How do you check it? Like, I want to check password also and capital pass also. Do check it out. I won't be telling you here, but you can check the man pages and maybe put the answer in Discord. Yeah, that's about grep. Okay, for grep is for searching patterns, right? What if you wanted to do the same, but with extensions? Another thing about extensions in Linux is, Linux doesn't actually care about the extensions. Like, usually if it's in Windows, right? The extensions are very important. .mp4, .html, .exe, or .m4 file. All of them are very important because that is how you know what type of file it is. But in Linux, actually doesn't matter. I can literally put touch i.vihar. That's minimal, yeah. And it'll still work. And but what is it? What type of file it is? So you need to know what type of file it is, right? To, like, in first glance, how do you know what? So for that, you do file and the file name. That'll tell you what type of file it is. For now, well, it's empty. So for example, this chal one here, that is the script I made. It has no extension, right? If I do file chal1, see, it's a bash script. It's an ASCII text. It's a bash script. So it knows it's a bash script as I use the chmod to, like, make it an executable. So because of that, it knows. And how does it know this is through something called magic bytes. Another thing you can check up on. It's a very interesting topic. Okay, so that is that is file and grep. So yeah, fine. Now, since you know, but imagine you do have extensions like this, okay, but you know there's one file with a particular extension. So in this wall of text, there's one file called pass. You can see it here, but imagine it is not there. You didn't do grep and grep didn't have it. You can't again keep searching in this wall, right? For that, you do find. Find is for the name of the file itself. It also checks the contents of it, but that's a secondary thing. So all I have to do is find dot. The syntax here is different. The second thing would be your the folder you're checking in. Here, unlike grep, you'll not need to do an minus r to check the directory. Because find is to find separate directories itself, right? To find the particular file name in the directory. So find dot, I do star dot pass. What does star do is, it checks for all the files which ends with dot pass. It's a type of regex. Yeah, that's one more thing you can check up on, regex. So star is for, like, all, basically it can start with anything, but it should end with dot pass. That's what this means. So if I do that, it found one, 68.pass. Forget the other, it's just searching for all of them. This is the final answer it got, 68.pass. So that is how do you find. And find is again another really powerful tool. You can search, like, it doesn't only search for names. You can search for particular things like who made the user. So minus u to, like, which user created it. What permissions does it have? Like, now we just checked out, right? Some permissions are there, like 755 and all that. So how do I know specific permissions? There are different different parameters for that too. So again, to check all of them, you can search the man find, and there are a lot you can look up into. Yeah. If man is too, like, big and you don't need the entire thing, and you know that you just forgot the parameter or something, you need a short description of the command, you can just do minus h or minus help. It's different for commands. You do minus help, it's almost similar to man, but it's a smaller one. Yeah, as you can see, it's pretty small. It'll just show you all the parameters available. So yes, that next, that is find, grep, done. Next we'll do with head. Okay, just another, I'll just show you how did we do that star thing. So imagine I want to delete all these text files because I don't need them now. So I just do rm. If you remember last class, rm is to remove star.txt. and enter. When ls, you see all are gone now. All of them are deleted. Only the path remained because it doesn't end with the .txt and the vihar thing we just created. So that's one way of doing. And the reason this also is important, this shows the power of rm, right? So for example, imagine now if I do rm minus r, okay, I'll go a folder behind because I want something to get deleted. No, I'll create a folder, wait. Let's create mkdir chal2 cd chal2. Okay, there's a folder. Yeah, there's a folder called chal2. And inside that chal2, there are multiple files in it. You want to remove the entire folder and everything inside that, like subfolders, subfiles, and everything. So you can do rm minus rf chal2. Chal2, right? Do an ls, now that's gone. And even if there are files inside it, the minus r would have taken care of it. Minus r is to recursively search. That's what was the grep minus r2, right? Minus r to recursively search through that folder. And even if there are subfolders, if I miss that, if there are subfolders, it'll check through that too. So now if you can imagine what would happen if I do rm minus rf slash, that is, that'll basically delete every file in your system. So this usually would not be possible if I use any other user, but I am root. If I am root and by some misclick I do that, you can imagine the consequences. So that is why the sudo command is so powerful and useful, and why not everyone uses root as default. Use your users. All right, let's move on to other text formatting files. Okay, I'll just show you. Let's take a big file, like a big text file. Let's take a word list. I have a very famous word list. It's called rocku.txt. Rocku.txt holds, I think, 10 million well-known passwords. It was leaked in one attack some years ago, lots of time ago, but it has almost 10 million lines of passwords. So how do I know that? I can do a WC. WC is to count the number of characters, lines, and words in the folder. So if I do WC rocku.txt, because if I open it, it will take forever to load. So you see, the first one is, I think, the number of lines. So that's how much. That is 14 million lines. This is words, almost same, because almost every line there's a one word. Sometimes there are more. And this is for characters, number of characters. So there are 14 million new lines in this, and almost 14 million, almost the similar number of words. So in this, I want to search like particular text. So again, grep would be useful here too. Now I can do grep, same password, and rocku.txt. Instead, now I'm not using minus r because I don't need to go through entire folders worth of content. I just need to check one file. So it's grep, password, rocku.txt. Enter. So these are all the passwords in rocku.txt with the word password. There are a lot. It's a common password itself and its things. Why would be using this password, this word list in general? We'll talk about it later. In fact, I think that's a class that's happening right now in intermediate, right? Password cracking. They'll be using the rocku.txt a lot. So that's the power of grep and searching patterns. So let's do some more string manipulations like that. Text formatting. So for example, I just want the first five lines or first 10 lines of rocku.txt. I can do something called head rocku.txt. By default, it does 10. I think 10 only, right? Yeah, first 10 lines. These are the first 10 lines of rocku.txt. Now I want to do the last. Again, this has many parameters. Like I can choose how many number of lines. I just want the first five lines. Sorry. Yeah, first five lines, it's like this. First 50 lines, yeah, I think you get the gist. And there are many other, again, if you want to search more about the command, just do a minus minus help or man. That's true for all the commands. Yeah, this is just to introduce you to most of these commands. Another one is tail. Since head was the first n lines, tail is the last n lines. Simple. So tail rocku.txt. txt. These are the last 10 lines. Yeah, it's a bit weird. These are back. It's just empty lines, so that's why it shows up like that. So that's tail. Yes, one more is sort. I don't want to sort on rocku.txt. Let me create now. Maybe let's create. Let's move on to our default folder. Actually, I do already have a text file. Yeah, I do have cat a.txt. So it just has some hi, hellos and everything. Now I want to sort it in an order. Like I want to keep it alphabetically sorted. So I just do sort a.txt. So he, right? He comes first in dictionary wise. So he, hi unique. Now imagine I want to make it unique. I want to sort everything in a particular folder and have only unique lines in it. Like I don't want this duplicates. There are so many duplicates here, right? So, okay, before that, I need to teach you one more thing. I need to teach you something called piping. What piping does is, now this is the output of sort, right? This text. Now I wanna give this output as input to one more file, to one more command. So that is done using piping. So it's basically output of this will be redirected to this. So if I do unique here, unique. So it will take the output of this and do a unique on that. This is, not all commands have like piping options. It is specific commands, especially the string formatting one, they almost definitely will have. So sort a.txt and unique. So yeah, there you go. It did it right. Hello, hi. I mean, it looks simple when it's like just a 10 letter. Imagine this was like 10,000 lines or something like that. In that, sorting everything from A to Z and unique and having the unique, you can do it like so easily. So that should tell you how powerful the commands are. Yeah, that is unique. Let's do some more. This time I don't have many examples, so I'll just tell you it's similar. One more is diff. Diff is to, well, difference between two lines, difference between the contents of two files. For example, you have a.txt, you have b.txt. So touch b.txt. So now I have an a.txt and a b.txt. I want the files that are in a.txt but not in b.txt, or reverse. I want the contents that is in b.txt but not in a.txt. Right? What's that called? Intersection, I think, right? So like that. So if I do a diff, intersection also, just call difference. a.txt, b.txt. So yeah, the red ones usually mean the ones in the first thing, and I think green shows you the nothing in the second. Just maybe put something in b.txt, then it might make more sense. Subl command will not exist in your thing because it's another third party thing I installed. It's Sublime Text, another text editor. All right, so just put some of the same ones also. Just bye. Okay, good. So yeah, now you can see, right? These are the ones that exist only in a.txt but not in b.txt, and these are the ones that exist only in b.txt but not in a.txt. So like that. And there are many more. It's a bit complicated, that these commands. So if you want to understand more, again, do use the man help or online. You can search it online. Similarly, there's cmp to compare two files, similar to diff. Now we'll go to the other string manipulation, text formatting commands, the tr, awk and cut. Okay, let's start with tr. So now I just want cat a.txt. All right, so it has hi, hello there in different ways. Imagine I want to replace every h with a backslash n. What do you need the back minuses just to stringify, squeeze. So I want to replace every H here with a backslash N. Backslash N, as most of you should know by now, is to enter a new line. It's to enter a new line instead of this. So instead of H, there'll be a new line there. So there's empty line, I, empty line, ELLO, like that. So yeah, there you go. It's there, right? So now H is replaced by I and stuff like that. It can also delete. It's simple, right? Instead of... it will basically replace every first letter with empty thing. I'm going to replace every H here. So H is gone. It's literally gone. Only I is there. So that you can do hello in general. So like that, you can do a lot of different functions using the TR tool. I think it's for translating or deleting is the official description of it. Yeah, translating or deleting characters. So main thing being characters and not words. That is very important. So another another important text formatting is awk. Awk is almost a programming language in its own. You can create entire scripts in Awk. It is similar to how these TR and other stuff works, except here there's a process for it. For example, you want first thing this does is the minus F is to set up a delimiter. What a delimiter does is it usually awk checks for different lines and gets returns particular values. For example, you have a line having maybe something like just make it sabal.txt. Hi, hello, bye. Right. So something like this. You have that. All right. So now you want to separate everything properly. Like I want hi. I just want to print all the first ones before the backslash, before the slash, or every second one, every third one. So for stuff like that, you can use the awk. Only thing is I need to set the delimiter as slash. So see, it did $3. $3 is the third one. So third one is bye, right? Bye. $2 would be the hellos and $1 would be the first one. This is just an intro again. There are some amazing things you can do with awk. You can create proper scripts. In fact, you'll be learning that in the third sem. So there are different stuff you can do with it. You can search more about awk online. One other thing is, yeah, I think we are done with the formatting tools. I mean, there are many more. You saw, right, the bin folder, how many binaries are there, and that's just in the bin folder. There are many tools available. These are the ones that are usually helpful for you in the for CTFs or exploiting. So that's the reason we're covering only these. All right, that is the end of the string manipulation and the text formatting. Now we'll come to networking commands. This is important because since we are working with OpenVPN, you're doing something called SSH, right? What is happening there? What does that command do? Let's see all of that. First, let's start with ifconfig. Ifconfig has your interface. It shows you all the interfaces that is available for you. Interfaces, network interfaces. These network interfaces are the way you connect to the different networks, pretty much. Yeah, your computer is connecting to this 10 dot something network. That is the NAT network we are running using ETH0 interface. This INET is your IP address. IP address is a unique address given to your computer so that it's distinguishable from maybe one more device in the same network. Imagine you have a Wi-Fi router in your home now. Then there are like multiple devices connected to it, right? How do you differentiate which one is your mobile, which one is your laptop, which one is this Kali, which is your TV and stuff like that? So your IP address would be to denote that specific address. That these three are the currently I am running dual, so both of them are unable. Usually your home networks will have this 192.168 configuration, and 10.0 is for your NAT networks. And if you guys already tried with OpenVPN and tried to connect with TriHack, even that will start with a 10.0 or 10.1 or something with a 10. That's the point. It is another internal network system. And local is for your local network. It's just for processes within your network. So those are IP addresses. Another thing you will need to know is ports. There are multiple ports in like your system. Like for example, ports are required for different protocols. For example, now your web is running on something called port 80. In fact, two ports, port 80 and port 443. If it's a HTTP, just HTTP, it's port 80. HTTPS is for port 443. So these different ports are for like different, you know, network, different ways in which you can connect to your network, right? Connect to your device, sorry. To connect to your device, you can use internet using browser. For example, your games have some particular ports. Now this SSH, you'll notice, will have another port. These are just different ways in which you some other device can access or send content to your network using the interface and through the port. So that is IP addresses and ports, right? So now we know at least something about that. Let's see SSH. What is SSH? SSH is for a secure shell. To get a secure shell of whatever the next part is. Next part is usually user at IP. Now you know, right? User is the the user of that particular user available in that machine and the IP address of that machine. And the default port it uses is 22, but you can, using the minus P, you can change the port. You will never have to do this unless specified, because most of your PCs run on most of your SSH runs on port 22. More on the how to search different ports and how to search through different IP addresses and get more details about them is again the intermediate session. That's the NMAP that's there running right now. That's what NMAP is. Now we know SSH. Now SSH is for getting a root shell on getting a shell. So if I do root at my current IP, localhost. Localhost is another like alias, alias for like your current system. This 127.0.0.1 localhost 0.0.0.0 all specify the same IP. That is your IP. That's your home IP. Basically, your computer. Localhost. Yeah, I think my SSH is even close. I don't even know on it. But I guess you get the gist, right? You see the TryHackMe website. They basically opened SSH in the victim machine, and you are accessing it using your machine. For SSH, you'll have, you need a password, and that password, after you enter, it'll ask you for a password. If you enter the password, it'll accept you. I'll give an example a bit later when I talk about the assignment for today. Another tool is NC, Netcat. Netcat is an amazing tool which is used to listen on different protocols. Now I told you, right? Now you can basically transfer messages through using these ports and using different protocols. There are three root protocols, that is like TCP, UDP, and other some, and a lot of smaller ones. So major ones are TCP root and UDP root. So Netcat will run through them. So it can allow you to transfer messages between two machines, like a messaging app kind of way. You can send text, you can send data, like you can transfer images, you can transfer files, you can transfer files, and later you'll also see you can even transfer you can even transfer control, you can even get shells using NC. It's a famous vector for getting exploits. Anyway, so imagine, I'll do it first locally. So imagine the parameters for NC is NC followed by IP followed by port, and if any other parameters are available, that. So I'm opening first I want to listen for some outgoing messages, like someone wants to talk to me, so I'm like opening a channel for it to like open. So if -L is for listening mode, so I open one listening port on my current device at port 952. So it is listening for network, it's listening for messages, like it's waiting for anyone else to like connect to this network. So currently I'm using the same network. So if I do NC localhost and 952, I'm connected to the network. How do I know that? I type something here, hi. It's reflected here, right? Now you can see the messages pass from basically two terminals here, but yeah, but it's two separate processes according to the operating system. So similarly, it's a two-way thing. So here also, if I do port, it shows up there. This will be useful like if you have multiple devices. So imagine, I think I still have the Kali I made last session. Okay. Yes. This is another Kali system. Just imagine it as any other machine that's running. The only thing is, imagine both of them are running on the same network. Right. Oh, I forgot. I think it's Kali Kali, no? All right. Let it start. I'll just check what is the IP of this machine. IP of this machine is 10.0.2.27. And okay. and just stop that netcat. Let's close this too. Now if config. See, ETS0, even this is on the same network, both have 10.0x, 10.0.2. It's just the last digit that's changing. That's the unique IP for the different machine. So I want to send messages from maybe here to here. So I'll open a listening on, no, I'll do the reverse. Imagine this is the victim machine and this is my attacking machine. So let's hope a port was opened. Someone is listening for messages here on port 9000. Arbitrary number. NC 10.0.2.27.9000. Did I do something wrong? It's listening, right? To check again if you can access one machine from to the same network, you can do a ping. Ping is true, it basically sends some messages to that machine, and hopefully if you get some responses, that means it's active, right? The machine exists. 10.0.27. Yeah, it does exist. Where did the ls work? What am I doing wrong here? Anyway, I will sort this out. Something wrong on my side, but I apologize for that. I'll look into it and I'll give you a clarification in the Discord group or in the next class. So yeah, but basically it's to communicate between different machines. Let's just leave it at that for now. All right, next. Okay, NC is done, SSH is done, IF config is done, and ping also kind of done. I think that was the networking section of that. Of Linux. I don't think anything else I forgot. Yeah, text formatting, string manipulation, networking commands, and file permissions. All of them are done. So yeah, I'm done with today's lecture. It's a bit faster. I have 20 minutes left. So any doubts about the current session first, please? You guys have any please.
What exactly is a binary? Is it a file or is it some secret?
No. Binary is a compiled code. For example, now you did Python, you know Python, right? Python files are interpreted code. So you don't need to compile them. But your C program, if you have worked with C, C++, you have to compile them first using a compiler. For example, let's write it. I don't know how good is my C programming, but... Hash include stdio.h. Hash include. I think that's enough. Not really much now. It's been some time. My C is very rusty. So forgive me if there are mistakes. Printf. Printf and just hello. Let's just leave it like that. I don't want to make much mistakes. Let's hope that works. We compile it. Unlike Python, we can't directly like run it. First, you need to compile that file. Oh, thank goodness, there was no errors. And now, what happens is, once it compiled, it creates a compiled executable. It creates an executable at the end. So that executable is what is your binary. Now, for example, for my Python file, if I do one cat hi.py, that's to display the contents of it. You can see the contents of it, right? Like in plain text. It's not the same with C. Now, let's actually make it much more clearer. Let the output file be named hi-c or whatever. Hi-c, yeah, let it be hi-c. I don't need extensions as I already told. But it's basically whatever, it's compiling a.c. Once it's compiled, the compiled code is in hi.c. Now if I do an lc, hi-c is there, right? Now if I do one cat hi-c, yeah, now you can't tell what's happening, right? You don't know, like, you can't see the command, how it was. It compiled it, converted to like some high level language in a way that the lower process can understand. So that's the reason, and most of the binary, okay, let's say softwares in C are written in Linux are written in C or other compiled codes. And this is just one, one single binary created from one file. Imagine there are multiple C files having many functions and many more libraries, as you saw the libraries folder. All of them come together and create one executable. That executable is called binary. It's your exe file. Just think of it as your exe file, .exe file, your final executable file, which you can run. Yeah. Any doubt? Any? Is that cleared anything up?
Yeah, I guess.
Yeah. It's basically your compiled, it's your executable file. It's your .exe. For example, now you run any of these commands here. These are like shortcuts to an executable, right? Oh, okay. No, mind. Now see, if I go to the actual file location, they are ending with a .exe. This is basically the compiled code of everything else, right? You are not working with these DLL files, right? You're just working with a .exe. Similarly here, these compiled binaries represent the final product, the one that the final user sees. Yeah. Okay. Any other doubts? Go ahead, we have a lot of time. If no other doubts, then I'll talk about the assignment, then we'll go for the doubts. Anyway, this week's assignment, if you guys already saw in Edmodo, is, well, the first is the third module of TryHackMe. Just I'll do TryHackMe again, because many of you still have the problem with TryHackMe. Okay, I'll do it inside here, because that is another issue. See, you need to download the OpenVPN config file from tryhackme.com. You need to log in. Don't know the password. Yeah, I seriously don't remember this. It's in the saved password. I'm not happy to do that on stream. Okay, before we do that, I'll tell you one more way. How do you send files from my Kali to my Windows and vice versa? At least one way works for me. For example, now I download something in my Windows file. So access, download my config file. For many of you guys, US East regular seems to work the best. So please do that. Mine is already new regular, so I don't want to change it. And some error, do regenerate it and download it again. Yeah. Download, I'll save it somewhere. Huh. Okay. So if you want to transfer this file from my, Windows to here, you need to add the guest editions CD image. And the extension that is available in the extension pack. I think it is there in the VirtualBox, right? Directly. VirtualBox.com. VirtualBox.org. Download. Yeah, here. This one. You need to do this. You need to install this in your VM. And I think you'll also need to install the guest editions ISO. I'm not sure how did we do that last time, but do look into the way to do that. Because once you do that, the reason I don't know exactly how to do it, but you should find tutorials. It's a bit fairly complicated process. But once you do it, the thing is you now have access to shared folders, shared clipboard and drag and drop. For example, I just want to copy this. I just do a Control C here and in terminal here in my VM, I can paste it. It makes stuff. That's your shared clipboard and your drag and drop. Now you'll see, I'll do it. Now I have my OpenVPN here, right, in my Windows. Just drag it and drop it. It usually works. Please, today is not my good day. I think I'm done. Usually it works. It's a lot finicky for me. It is quite the thing, but sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. But basically you can do the drag and drop directly. I don't know what am I doing wrong, but yeah, I will look on that too. What is the issue with that? Yeah, but that way you can
download the file in Linux.
That's the best way to do it. I don't want to put my username password here, so that's the reason I'm not doing it. All right, I'll just tell you guys, just do that instead. Open this here and put your username password here and do it. I don't remember them right now, so I'm not doing it. Download it here. All right, once you download it, it'll be in the download folder. All right. It will not be universally shown everywhere. it'll be in your downloads folder. Open that folder. See, yeah, this is your download folder. I have lots of stuff. So one thing to do is, well, you're specified on I'll make one directory, and from there I'll run it. Well, cd into that directory. All right, and then copy. Cp is for copying. Not said that yet. Cp, first part is your from and last is your destination. You want to copy something from here, from my downloads directory. So it's slash root. How do I know that's right here? Slash root slash downloads slash, I see that's a A. I want to download it to current directory dot. Okay, that's not thing. Oh, it downloads. Yeah, now if I do an ls, see A is there now. You need to either, you can do this or directly open your terminal in this folder itself. That's another way to do it. So now I'm in the folder, the root downloads folder, and then you can do your OpenVPN followed by the name of your file. Yeah. It won't work because that's not the file, but yeah. So like that, you just have to do it. I know many of you guys are still having problems with the file type some are having and other ones. We will fix them in the, we are searching for problem answers, and we'll discuss like that on the Discord itself. Yeah, so thing is, yeah, you need to install it, and the most easiest ways, that's it. So sudo apt install, the basic ways, that apt install OpenVPN, and then copy that file to the current folder or cd into that. If you don't want to do both and you just want it wherever it is and you just want to do it, is use a relative path. So OpenVPN, you saw it where it was, right? It was in slash root slash downloads and slash whatever, slash a or something like that. So you can run it like that too. These are different ways to connect into OpenVPN. And one more thing is, once it starts, please don't exit the terminal. You don't close the terminal or do a control C to close it. You'll have to keep it running, because I'll show you now that you know what is ifconfig, you'll maybe understand a bit more. So yeah, once it's created, I'll just create one new terminal. Open tab. Now if I do an ifconfig, now you notice there are not three, there are four. That's one TU and zero tunnel, and this is your IP address for the TriHackMe network. So if you can, now you can connect two and two together. So what's happening here is, now you're basically connecting to the network where these boxes exist, where these virtual boxes running these the victim boxes are existing. So you're basically connected to the same network, and you can access them using the deploy. You get that IP address, right? So now you can access them. If you're disconnected, like, see, if I do one now, by mistake I close this or do one control C, it's gone. It'll be not there here. That's it. Your that interface has closed. So do keep it running in the background, and do whatever other commands you need to do in another terminal. So like that, you should do Linux fundamentals 3 this time. It's pretty much what we have done now, and some extra if I missed. Find, grep, sudo, nano. Nano is another, I think I told last class, but I just reiterate. It's just a like terminal based file editor. You can write something. Hi. Yeah, that's not appropriate. All right, you can type whatever you want. And to get out of this, it's, you can see here, it's the symbol is for control X. Then it asks you, do you want to save it? I want to press CY for this. File to write name is a.txt. So press enter and you're out. Like nano, and there are other commands, and yeah, ln and all, you'll see the importance of that, and use of the binary and other ones, other different commands. You can just practice and understand them. The second part of that is, I think, bandit, right? Bandit is overthewire.org. You just go to overthewire.org. I'll put this link in the beginners class, and you click on bandit because that is the one you're gonna work on. Basically, these are like challenges. Unlike TriHackMe, you don't get any box. This is hosted like properly, so you just have to access this website. How do you access this? Now you learned SSH, so you must be able to figure out. Like, I'll tell you the main points. CSSH, you have the username, you have the IP. I mean, let's think it as host address. This is your, this is the closest thing you have to an IP. So you have to put this at this, and it's not the usual port. It's not your port 22. It's port 2220. So like that, you SSH into that machine, and once you log in, you'll have to basically level up. How do you level up? They'll basically give you the password for the next level in some folder or some binary or some other way. So you'll have to figure it out where it is, find the password, and you know, like that, log into the next one. So now bandit zero. Okay, I'll do one. I just do zero. I don't want to assist much, but all right, SSH bandit zero at this rate. And minus P for port 2220. It'll ask you, does it want to connect? Do you want to continue connecting? Say yes. Password. Password is bandit zero. BANDIT0. You'll not see it there. Told you last time. Yeah. So now you have a shell of bandit zero user in that machine. The user machine is being this. This is a machine. It internally has an IP associated with it. How to look into that, we'll see in future classes. Just a second, guys. Just one. Hello, I'm back. Can you guys hear me? Hello. Hello, can you hear me, guys?
Yeah.
Sorry for that. Where was I? You got into this user, right? Bandit zero. So now you need to so now you have basically come to level zero to level one. So how do you go to level one? They said it's in a file called readme stored in the home directory. Use the password inside the readme to level up to SSH zero. So imagine I found the password. I won't do it at all. So figure out, now you know the different commands, right? There is ls, there is cat, there is copy, there is mkdir, there are different options available. So you'll have to use them in conjunction to get the, just read the files of this and use that to get the password. Once you get the password, this time they said whenever you find a password for a level, use SSH on the same port to log into that level. What that means is, now once you get the password, all you have to do is from bandit zero, it will become bandit one. Password they'll ask, and like I told you, you know where we'll find the password. Find the password in like using the instructions given there, find the password. For this, you just have to tell the first five, so five levels. It's easy. Not everything I'll tell you is like totally available the way. If you just read my classes, if you just went to the class, you will not be able to do it. You'll have to go to the man pages. Understand, like for example, how do you check hidden files? How do you check, open files with spaces in them? That's a nice one actually. It's in a file called minus. How do you access that? So look into it. Even they give you hints and everything. So go through it and just do it till the first file. And you need to do, you need to submit something called a write-ups. That's another thing a lot of you have asked. So I'll just tell you what is a write-up. It's just documenting what you're doing. For example, just create one empty Word doc, or if you are doing it in Kali cherry tree, just tell, you know, just write some, you know, 0 day and whatever, that title and everything. So bandit zero, how did you do it? So first SSH, use command SSH to get into the shell, write it down like that, then screenshot it and paste the screenshot there. And like that, you should basically explain how you got the answer. Does that make sense? Like just your process, how you have solved the challenge. That's it. I don't need you to tell you Google this and that. I just need you to tell which command you used and maybe how you got there. If it's Google, you don't need to mention it. Or maybe if you did using the man or help page, mention that. A small screenshot on how you did it. And that's it. Just send it to us on Edmodo. Just for the first five, for the first week, you just have to
do
the
first one.
Yes.
and drag and drop the screenshots that I took on the VM onto the laptop directly. Well, if I have bi-direction.
Yes, it should work. Right now for me it's not working. Technically it should work. But the easiest way is if you are doing it on VM, take a screenshot using your Windows one, right? Print screen. I don't know the exact command.
X5 that is not working. Alt print screen is only working.
Wait. I'm saying if you're using it on VM, no, just instead of clicking on your VM, instead of doing the command inside the VM, like I'm guessing you did this and you got something like this, right? This is how you do it within inside your VM. But if you're using the VM directly, then just take control outside your VM. Just click on your taskbar or something outside the VM and then do your print screen. Then you can basically take a screenshot, right, of your machine. And then you're in your Windows, so you can do whatever you want with that.
I didn't try that.
Yeah. If it's bi-directional, yeah, you can just drop it. But it is very finicky. For me, bi-directional never worked. Unidirectional used to work, like from my Windows for Kali. That also some errors have come now. So I'll look into that. But it is
also this prime text on the VM itself.
I'm sorry, I couldn't get that. What
is that an extension? Yeah, is that Sublime Text, the original version?
Yes, that
version,
is Sublime Text. It is Sublime Text. That's a proper tutorial to how to do that. Just Google it, Sublime Text on Linux. Sometimes you might not get Kali. Kali is a Debian version of Linux. I don't know what's it called. Flavor, Debian flavor of Linux. So check for IAL. So if the same commands which will work for on Debian will work on Kali. I think the dot for Kali will work. Just Google it, find tutorials and do it. That's the way at least I did it. Just follow the commands, they just do it. Wget is a command to it's like a download manager kind of way to download whatever this file from a website directly. It's a very cool tool. I'll go through more of them in the next class. So yeah, update install. There are different ways to do this. Like that, I installed it. You can install any other software like that if the tutorials are available online. Yeah. Anything else?
Hello. I have a doubt.
Yes.
I actually got stuck in the second room of the TryHack meeting.
Okay.
So I did not submit the assignment. So is that okay or?
Okay. That is a question. Late submissions are still allowed, but multiple late submissions will be not good for you. It's because sooner or later we will remove you if you're not active at all. If you're not joining the classes, if you're not, interacting with us, we will have to remove you. But for one, it's fine. We will excuse
How
you for it.
This one then?
How do you submit?
The first one.
It's simple, I thought. Just complete it. If you complete it, you get 100%, right? Just take a screenshot of this and send it to us. That's it.
Now, will the Edmodo assignment links still be available?
I didn't understand.
Like Edmodo, will that still show me?
Yeah. Late submissions is possible.
Okay.
Yeah, late submission is still there.
Hello?
Yes.
Can you explain me the environment variables and export?
Okay. Environment variables are the different. One second. Just before that, just at late submission. I think, yeah, you can see the late, right? You can still submit it. So
yeah. Okay.
Yeah. Do that. Anyway. On to your command. Your thing was the export thing, right? Environment variables are the different variables like that is already there. You can access them using env. I think I did that last class. So to set a new environment variable, it's using export, right? Export, the name of the variable you want to create. For example, the variable name is hi, equal to the what do you want it to point to? I is equal to 123. Okay. So now if I do echo is to print that particular content. So if I do echo 123, it'll just print it on the terminal. But if I put dollar followed by that without quotes, so if I do dollar hi now, hi, you see now you get 123. So it's the way to like check all the environment variables. So that's the same way how the path and other variables work. That's how you get your binaries and stuff like that. So that's basically it. I think you are asking this for the try-hack meeting, right? I think it's this should work like that. I think it's just test 1, 2, 3 equal to something and just print it, and then if you run the binary it should work.
Is there any practical application for this?
Yeah, there are a lot of practical applications for this. For example, now see this path, that's first thing it goes to the path. Sorry if I'm doing that a lot. Where's the path? Well, user is another important one. User will tell you, if I do $user, it'll tell you the current user. Echo $user will give you the current user. $path will make sure like from which path your binaries come from. So it'll search for in this folder for your binary search. For example, now if I do OpenVPN. What is happening internally is it's $path. It's running $path/that. Does that make sense? Like use like that, then the executable is opening from the dollar and then we are getting it internally. Like you won't see it working here, but that's how your binaries are working directly from here. Now echo again will be stored, the binary is not in this folder, right? It's not in this directory, it's somewhere in one of those folders. It'll search to each one of these paths and then append it and then run that. So like see something like that. Yeah, just one of them. It'll search through one of them. There'll be probably a C program somewhere running and it'll append it and run it. So that's how, that's one use of it. In fact, you can like, now you saw you can create your own environment variables, right? So those things will stay forever. I mean, unless you remove them or something. So for example, now I have a default path. Default folder I want to go to. That is export $0day. Equal to /home/kali/0day. Oh, sorry, dollar is in the wrong place. My bad. There's no need to be dollar. Yeah, what did I do wrong? This. What did I do wrong? I'm confused. Oh, yeah, sorry, I think the space. That it? Yep. Yeah, space. That's one more thing. Space and everything matters a lot. Can remove that. Yeah, if I do now $0day, see now I can directly cd with $0day. Imagine this is a longer thing, right? Now I have an alias for that, like this. Now I can create some shortcuts and stuff like that, and later, like for example, you'll be working with different IPs, right? When you are exploiting, for each, if you created a like one like proper structure on how you exploit, first thing you need is to get the IP. Instead of always like finding the IP and like maybe checking ifconfig or something like that, just to do export .ip equal to, you know, the IP which you, the maybe my current IP, that is what, 10.0.2.15 or something like that, right? So then it's saving time and space. This is how you can use the compiler. So the OS itself is using all of these. All of them mean something. The xterm, where's it? Term is equal to xterm will be used to like check what type of bash. It's a parameter for bash, like how like is your bash colored or not colored and stuff like that. There are a lot more. It is similar to the environment variables in Windows, which we will come to in like I think 2 more sessions. That's it. Not the next session. After that, even here you have environment variables. Well, for your Java, maybe for your Python. You'll see this path folder, you'll see there are a lot. How do you use these? I will tell you more about it in the Windows session. Yeah, I guess that should clear your doubt, right? There are a lot of applications. Yeah. Yeah. Anything else, guys?
Hello?
Yes.
It's like I had a doubt in the word list thing.
Okay.
Like, is it inbuilt or like?
No. I installed it. You will only have /opt.
Like how do you install the Subl?
Subl, you saw the way, right? I literally showed you the tutorial page.
Yeah,
like that. And for example, for the word list, I will Google it. Simple as that. 99% of cybersecurity is Googling. I just Google rocku.txt.
Fine.
Rocku.txt. See, that's the most one of the famous ones. So there's some GitHub. There you go. Then I download it for you. Save it and I just moved everything to that /opt. There are a lot more. Mm-hmm. Some I'll give you more resources. There are some amazing resources available, not just for Rocky.exe. There are many more word lists, many more exploits available. We'll talk more about that once we hit intermediate level.
Fine.
Yeah. Any other doubt, guys?
I had a doubt in the assignment.
Yes.
For the second, other than try hack me, the other one, how do we submit the screenshot? Like, what screenshot do we take?
Screenshot of your Kali, right? That's pretty much. I showed you, right? You open a Word doc, just explain what commands you use to get it, right? And maybe a little more text on how you got it, how you got the command and what command you typed, and just a screenshot of you using that command. You did ls, you got the output. Just take a screenshot of that and paste it in that Word and send it to us. And okay. look out
that for just, the package, right?
I'm sorry, what?
Because I didn't do that for the...
Yeah, that's what I meant. The reason why I told you guys to do it for last is because, well, you'll have to keep doing it from at least this one. If I just type for CTF write-ups, which is the most famous ones, I'll show you some default write-ups at least. Maybe you guys might understand it better. Where are they? Write-ups, PVP, where is it? Okay. I'll just not go from here. Just going to get something like that. So it's just to document your work, right? How you did last time, and hopefully it'll help you later in the future. Okay, just didn't even write anything. For example, you explain your challenge, how you did it. Your input was this, so in your command was that. Then you wrote the code. Well, for you guys, you don't need code or anything. You'll come later for that. So your code, just put your screenshot here. Just like one small story, like just how you did it. Nothing more than that. We're not going to judge you on your write-ups or anything. We just need to know how you did it. That's it. There's no...
For my first assignment submission, I just took a screenshot of all the pics that I got.
Yeah, that's fine. But from now, still, even for the third Linux module for IntraHackMe, you can do the same. You can just take the screenshot of your 100% of your tick or your or you doing all the tasks, whichever it is, and submit it to us. But for bandits, you'll have to submit a write-up.
I thought I would take screenshots of my code and the answer which I got.
For the upcoming assignment?
No. For bandit.
Yes, that's fine. Just a little bit of text too, please.
Explanation as well.
Yeah, a little small. I don't need you guys to write paragraphs. Just, I got this command using man. The command was ls minus alh. That's it. And your screenshot of it. After ls, I found that I found... No, you don't need to know I found or anything also. Command ls minus alh. Found using mandb. Screenshot. Like that. The more better it is, it's beneficial for you guys only. I'm not going to do anything with these write-ups, because later when you are using for pen testing, you'll have to submit a detailed report on how you did it. In that report, you'll have to write which IP you used, which port you used, how did you get that exploit, and a lot more. I'll show you one sample. Let's see. I have a better sample. This is not good. Not this. So like that, there are different you'll have to document your work, even if not now. It'll be helpful for you later too, because here it is. Well, not even this. That's a better one. Well, this is just smaller write-ups, but the good ones. Well, a final report, at least if you're writing some proper exam, would be where is it? Yeah, there you go. CTF template. So how did you enumerate? So which ports did you get? Which commands you used on exploitation? See the service exploited and all that stuff. Now it might look really complicated, but slowly as you start writing write-ups, documenting your work, these things becomes easier. That's the only reason we are asking you to submit write-ups. So that is a benefit of doing it. So try to do it good. Yeah.
can use like Word files and
yeah,
stuff.
Yeah, Word is more than enough. Yes, Word is more than enough. Just Word, just small description and the screenshots are more than enough. Yeah. Anything else, guys?
Yeah, I have a question. You were able to SSH into the Bandit Zero without the need for like OpenVPN or something. So why did we need it?
That's a nice question, actually. TryHackMe basically puts you in a network which already holds these machines. When you deploy, those machines are started and you are basically deployed in one network. For example, it's like connecting to your connecting to TryHackMe's Wi-Fi, things like that. You're connecting to TryHackMe's Wi-Fi. In that Wi-Fi, the Linux fundamental machine exists. So now you can talk to it. This is basically on the internet, this thing. It's hosted publicly. It is on www. So this is a public machine. Anyone can access it without any extra network. Like, we don't need to, it's not a local network, it's public. So we don't need to use OpenVPN. Does that clarify?
Yeah. Cool. Thank you.